Approximately 25 knots. We're getting a good radar return, so you should be able to pick it up pretty easy on your F-86 scope.
What scope? Don't tell me you're flying an F-86D.
Yeah, but it's a fifth phase job. How long do you think that storm will last? It should be at its worst in about an hour. Fine. I'll take off in about 30 minutes. Another chapter for your book. You phase 5 pilots must be crazy.
Crazy like a fox. That information comes in mighty handy when you're on the gauges. You guys are making the panic button obsolete.
Well, it's a long haul. I started working on the F-86D over 2 years ago.
No kidding. Has it really been in the mill that long?
Sure has. I'll never forget the first time I saw a drawing of the dog. The model spec book had just arrived, and the chief threw it in my lap. I found the drawings right away. The radar nose reminded me of the P-40 I flew in World War II. Studying the specs, I found it even had an afterburner. Since I had been appointed project officer, I presided at the fifth phase section review a couple of days later. We commented on the deficiencies we were able to find. For example, it didn't have any thunderstorm lights, and the cockpit needed rearranging. Several weeks later, I checked these items at the mock-up and found a few new ones. I couldn't reach the autopilot release without sliding my hand down the stick. The flying safety representative thought this was pretty sad too. So I filled out a request for alteration and got the flying safety people to concur. It wasn't long before I had a pile of RFAs, which I turned into the board and, in a few minutes, headed for the hotel. In a couple of months, we were notified that our aircraft was about ready for delivery. So I went out to the factory and got thoroughly briefed. This took 3 or 4 days, and then I ferried the aircraft back to Wright-Patterson. Everybody got a charge out of seeing it for the first time. But it was quite a while before they saw it again. Our instrumentation specialist took over and installed a recording photo panel. In some of the new fighters, it's hard to find space for this equipment. In fact, we had to put the panel in the rocket section of the F-86D. We used this installation to obtain data during our weather flights. As soon as the calibrations of the panel were made, the aircraft was turned back to Phase 5 to begin the test program. During the first couple of flights, we calibrated the flight instruments using a Pacer aircraft. The next time we flew, it was a perfect day for a crosswind takeoff. The wind was 40 knots from 90 degrees. Thanks to the afterburner and a short takeoff run, the wind didn't have a chance to weathercock the aircraft. Holding a heading for even this short a period was pretty rough. The extra power from the afterburner gave an odd presentation on the attitude indicator because of the acceleration errors in the instrument. After cleaning up the aircraft and establishing climb speed, a series of climbing turns were made to altitude. Angles of bank up to 60 degrees could be made with safety, but beyond 30 degrees they got pretty hairy. Although this flight was made primarily to check crosswind takeoff and landing, every aspect of the aircraft was evaluated, as it is during each flight. It was still a nuisance to have the radio controls on the right console, and the UHF transmissions were coming in garbled. About this time, the volume of the range signal started building rapidly, and a few seconds later, the Z marker lit up. Setting up the power and airspeed that had been selected for this flight, the descent was soon stabilized. Flight closely, recording a ground plot and current weather data. When a third of the altitude was gone, a 90-degree penetration turn was made, maintaining the same airspeed and descending while turning. First, a single needle width, 90-degree turn to the left, and then immediately over into a 270-degree turn to the right. The 86 ended up smack on the beam, and I kept on descending until it was time to start intercepting the initial approach altitude. A couple of minutes of level flight brought me across the station, ready to make a low approach. By this time, with idle power and speed brakes, I had slowed the aircraft to the airspeed the engineer had figured would be the best, using a new power setting to maintain this airspeed. Minutes later, I initiated another 90-degree method procedure turn and descended to the final approach altitude. I came right back into the range leg, and after completing my cockpit check, crossed the station at final approach altitude. During the low approach, I extended the speed brakes to give the proper rate of descent without changing the power setting. A minute or so of this, and I broke out, fat, dumb, and happy, in position for a normal landing. To check our missed approach procedure, I advised approach control that I was going around. When I reached the range station, I requested a GCA with a full stop landing. This would be a max brake landing to determine the runway length required for a 200-foot ceiling. The ground crew was standing by. GCA controlled me through a normal pattern, and when I entered the glide path, they alerted the ground crew. As I broke out, I could see the crash crew, ready in case I blew out a tire, and the measurement team along the approach end of the runway, waiting to record the exact point of touchdown. The entire operation was being photographed through a grid to provide runway distance and altitude data. After the aircraft had slowed down sufficiently, I applied the brakes intermittently, being careful not to skid the wheels,